You'll be pleased to know that I'm not going to sing, and more importantly, we're not going to sing together. So thank you for the opportunity to speak today. We are going to split, we're going to do a double act, it's probably the better language. I'm going to quickly introduce the recently published report Heading for the Open Road, and Michael is then going to give some observations on the implications for SDM publishers particularly. For brevity, I'm going to restrict myself to summarising some of the key points, which means, I think, in Frank Schirmacher's language, I'm going to give you the banal version. If you want the dense read, or should I say the deep read, then have a look at the paper. That's what the summary version looks like, and there's an even more detailed version available on the website. Prior to this work, I think it's fair to say that the economic analysis of alternative publishing models typically focused on static comparisons between the world now and what it might look like in a wholly or almost wholly open access world in the future. The study that we did with Michael and Rin aims to answer the more difficult questions about the economics of partial transition to open access and also about the process of getting there. It's important, I think, to be clear that our analysis seeks to come at these issues without an agenda, other than to expose what we see as the evidence on the issue from an independent perspective. As the slide indicates, the work was a joint production between SEPA and Mark Ware. And the funders were actually drawn from the full range of stakeholders interested in this subject. Some of the discussions and debates which I was party to were quite interesting. The ones that I wasn't party to were even more interesting, I gather. So the study is best described, I think, as a UK-focused cost-benefit analysis of alternative approaches to increasing access to peer-reviewed articles. It's important to emphasise the UK focus. Although the analysis can readily be repeated for other countries, a key determinant of some of the results is what one might call the balance of trade, i.e. whether a country is an exporter of articles or an importer compared to its contribution to the funding of global publication and distribution costs. So the results change depending on which country you would look at. Our focus was on the UK. At the highest level, moving across the chart here, it involved three pieces of work: defining a set of scenarios, modelling and analysing them, and then a discussion of the results. Given the time, I'm going to focus just on two of the scenarios, the green and the gold, but just for information, the three other ones that we looked at were an increase in the number of publishers providing free embargoed access, that's delayed, and a national license extension in the UK, licensing, and then a transactional scenario involving improvements in pay-per-view. The general point to note about these scenarios is that they were intended to be as part of a mixed economy, and five-year plausible scenarios. And by plausible, I mean moderate changes in the business model, as opposed to extreme. And for all of them, we have compared them against what is essentially a policy-neutral projection into 2015, or a business as usual. So they all get compared against a common, if you like, baseline. So a couple of words on the scenarios. There's a lot more detail on what sits behind in terms of assumptions in the papers, but the green scenario, importantly, is an embargoed green, as opposed to the green of many advocates. So it's about depositing discipline and institutional repositories of the accepted manuscript after an embargo period. In the gold scenario, we see an increase in author-side payment business models, providing open access to the version of record. And in all of these cases, the assumptions that we use vary by the different subject groupings. I think to pick up on the point that Stephen makes, although it's legitimate in many ways to compare these as alternative mechanisms for access, they are fundamentally different creatures. Gold is about and captures all the costs associated, or potentially does, that remains to be seen, the costs associated with the production of your output. Green is just about access. It's an additional cost that sits on top of the real costs of the business of publishing. So let's look briefly at some of the results. Transaction and ongoing costs of green, actually they're very low, and the reason why they appear relatively low is that our 2015 background policy neutral scenario actually has all of these repositories built. So from a policy perspective, the key question is, if you've built them, should you use them? And if you are going to use them, how do you do so in a way that's sustainable? But we also looked at a version which assumed that there was zero green deposits and no repositories. And clearly, that gives you a much higher set of costs and is probably a better comparison, notwithstanding what I just said about the difference between green and gold in terms of cost effectiveness. In gold, you'll see in the report, we distinguish between one-off upfront costs, and those relate to the first 5 years, the slope that you see. And these here, for gold, are about a fundamental shift in the funding of scholarly communications to a varying degree, depending on the sector. It requires a shift of rhetoric from support amongst funders in the UK and elsewhere to actual mechanisms to ring-fence funding of APCs, at least in the short term. The ongoing costs that we look at are very significantly dependent on the level of assumed APCs. And we look at two dramatically different levels of APC, dramatically different in terms of the impact. The what we call the higher APC results in a cost. And that higher APC is based on the work that we did in 2008 that estimates the average cost across the industry per article. The lower APC is the weighted average cost currently of gold open access journals. So in this next slide, essentially we're dividing the costs, the average cost that we've just looked at, by the total level of access or the change in access for each of the scenarios. And what you observe is actually quite similar to the time series, because the levels of access in each of those scenarios, or the changes in access, is similar. Quite a dramatic range in the gold case, depending on the APC, and then a relatively low cost for green per unit of access, which increases fairly dramatically if you are comparing against a zero baseline. So, because I need to wrap up and let Michael talk about the implications, I think the report came to a pretty clear preferred option, and I think, having just listened to Stephen, I suspect this is the evidence, or I'd like to think it's the evidence, for the manifesto that Stephen's just presented. For a start, it's the only sustainable open access model, that's clear. From an economics perspective, I also think it has very significant advantages in terms of economic efficiency, improving the link between the cost of the publication, or making sure there is a link in the cost of the publication to the authors who are the, at least initially, the primary beneficiaries of its publication. But there are very significant risks associated with this, which need to be tackled and cannot be tackled by government alone. It needs to be tackled in partnership with the publishers. And these relate to, for example, the fact that the existence of savings, even in the low APC case, only occur if there's a reduction in subscription costs offsetting the APC, the double-dipping issue. And I think, by the way, there's an issue there on the content, but there's also a really serious issue on communication where the industry has not done itself any favours. And then lastly, although we think the APCs of around £2,000, which is essentially the break-even point, should be achievable, there are clearly questions about the sustainable average level. And remember, this is an average. It's not saying that all gold articles need to be charged at that level. whether as we move to a different, or at least let's say as we as more higher rejection rate or traditional peer review journals become gold, whether that £2,000 is actually sustainable. Lastly, one more point. All of this analysis assumes that the whole world moves in tandem. Clearly, if any one country moves faster or slower, that has a very big impact on the benefits to any one country. So I will leave it and hand it to Michael.
Thank you.
Right, my job, I think, is to try to talk through some of the key messages and some of the implications of the analysis that that Daniel has just been speaking about. And I should emphasise that one of what I see as the great strengths of this study is that it did benefit in the way that Stephen was actually talking about, from very close engagement between a variety of stakeholders, funders, publishers, librarians, and researchers themselves. But I guess that some of the key messages actually are for funders and policymakers, and so that's the group I'm actually going to start with, by talking about the policy context here. There is absolutely no sign that I can detect of loss of interest by policymakers and funders in the whole issue of how to enhance access to scholarly journals and the outputs of research. In the UK, we have now seen recently the establishment of an independent working group of key stakeholders, independent but initiated by government, to look at these issues. In Germany, we've got the Max Planck Institute, the Deutsche Forschungsgemeinschaft, showing increasing interest in these issues. The EU Commission is continuing to push ahead on these kinds of issues. And I think that is very much linked to agendas that are fairly common amongst funders and policymakers on transparency in the research community, but transparency more generally, the search for socioeconomic returns to the investments that they are still making in research. And I think they see quite close connections between access and these kinds of agendas. I think the second point I would want to emphasize is that our conclusion from a policy perspective is that really the non-open access mechanisms for enhancing access didn't actually have many policy levers associated with them. It wasn't clear how policymakers could actually make an impact towards their goal of enhancing access that way. And I think we need to recognise that green open access, as well as gold, does have attractions for policymakers and for institutions. There are lots of positive exemplars, some of which I've put up here, which seem to work quite well. Green open access plays into the agenda for promoting the visibility of research. It plays into an agenda that is important to many universities for finding ways of actually monitoring and evaluating their research activity and the impact of that activity. And as Daniel has already said, the infrastructure has been built and is being further developed as we speak. And I think finally, the attractiveness of gold does depend critically upon price. For the UK, if the price is under £2,000 on average, $3,000, something over €2,000, it is very attractive indeed, but with the caveats that Daniel has already mentioned. I think it's then worth looking at the market context that we're operating in. A market context in which purchasers, in the form of universities and university libraries, are becoming increasingly cost conscious. The directors of research libraries in the UK recently had no difficulty at all in persuading their vice chancellors, presidents of their universities, that they should take a very tough stance indeed, certainly very tough compared with anything that they had done before, in negotiating the renewal of big deals, and actually being prepared to look at alternatives to the big deal. And they got a lot of international interest in the library community, certainly, for the kind of stance that they were taking. So these kinds of cost-conscious pressures are not going to go away. But of course, from the other side, from the supply side, I think we are in a situation where we have seen significant growth, obviously, of both journal titles and published articles in OA journals, and the particularly rapid growth of the mega journals that that Mark talked about this morning. But much lower growth, and I'll come on to some of the reasons for this in a moment, in open access publishing in hybrid journals. But I think, again, to reflect on the green road, I mean, there is a certain amount of evidence now accumulating of a growth in the use by researchers and others of green open access repositories. So all this, it seems to me, gives rise to some challenges for publishers. Now, I'm not going to say anything here that's very startling or original, it seems to me. I mean, clearly the market is going to continue to evolve in conditions where there is going to be continued pressure on prices, where there's going to continue to be a tension, and I suspect a growing tension, between the desire from both the supply side and the demand side for better services, new services on the one hand, and a willingness, certainly on the demand side, to pay the price for those services. And of course, there is continuing pressure on prices for publishers, not least because of the growth of the open access movement itself. And I think it's also worth noting that since the biggest element of growth in the open access market itself has tended to be in the mega journals at the $1,350 or around that kind of price, I think it's going to become increasingly difficult actually for new entrants to come in at significantly higher prices. There will be price resistance, cost resistance from the demand side. And so obviously this presents a quite complex market environment for publishers. But what I'd want to emphasise, I think, is the two big communications challenges here. I think that publishers candidly have not done a good job in being clear about to their authors and to their readers and to their funders, their ultimate funders, about the benefits as well as the risks of the green road. I think also, and I'm pleased that Stephen agrees with me on this, that particularly with regard to hybrid journals, publishers need to be much more transparent and much more proactive in being forthcoming about what their pricing and their cost models are in a hybrid environment. There is a huge amount of suspicion in the library community and beyond that you have got to overcome. So being absolutely clear about the relationship between the growth, if it takes place, of the number of open access articles that you publish and subscription prices for hybrid journals, that's absolutely essential. And I say that knowing that it is not as simple as some librarians tend to assume. But in a way, it seems to me that the bigger challenges, or at least as big challenges, are for universities and funders and policymakers. They face a system, or they have created a system, where funding does not easily flow into open access publishing. The basic funding system for research in most countries of the world, with the US as something of an exception, provides two main flows of public funding for research. One, to fund infrastructure of which libraries and the contents of libraries are a key part, and a separate flow of funding to meet the direct costs of specific research projects. If we are going to move more rapidly than we have over the past few years towards a gold open access system, that funding system has to change. We have to be able to fund open access publishing through the direct costs of research. It's not going to come from infrastructure in the way that it has up to now. So meeting the costs of OA is going to demand quite significant, even fundamental changes in funding regimes for the research community, whether it's in the UK, certainly across Europe. So a large-scale transition towards OA does pose real challenges for universities, not least because there will be winners and losers, not only at national level, as Daniel has already spoken about, but even within national systems for research-intensive and less research-intensive universities. And don't get the impression that universities and the senior management in universities and policy institutions aren't aware of the risks to sustainability during a transition period. So what are my conclusions? I think firstly, clearly we are in a transition towards a more open access world. We just don't know how far it's going to go, how fast it's going to go. We probably do know that it's going to differ in different subject areas. I think we also know that the distinction between green and gold is not as clear-cut as it's often painted. Think of the relationship between the Wellcome Trust and UK PubMed Central, for instance, which makes a quite explicit connection between payment for gold and deposit in a green open access repository. So as I'm sure Chris will say more about, and he has said in print, we need to rethink the distinction between green and gold. But I think my key message is that funders, as well as publishers, have some complex issues and problems to tackle in what is a complex and changing environment. But for funders, having a clear aim to move towards greater transparency, more open access, isn't the same as knowing how to get there. They don't know exactly how to get there at the moment. And in that environment, it seems to me that a key message for publishers is that you need to be aware of funders' motivations as well as their policies, and not to overplay your hand. Talk of things like unfunded mandates, of restrictions on researchers' choice, I don't think get you anywhere. In a modern economy, in a modern society, there are unfunded mandates imposed by governments all over the place. Think of health and safety legislation. Think of employment legislation, for example. And it is not uncommon for contracts, which is what research grants are, after all, for contracts to involve obligations and restrictions on the activities of both sides. So researchers are quite au fait with the idea that when they accept money from research funders, there are restrictions on what they can do. And I don't think they find restrictions on how they can publish any more onerous than lots of other restrictions on their activities. So it seems to me in that kind of environment, there is everything to be said for working together, for engaging in the kind of way that Stephen has already spoken about. Both sides in this debate have problems that they need to solve, and they better solve them together. Thank you very much.
Thank you, too.